feel comfortable, you stand to your feet with us. But we're going to bless him in this place. Hallelujah. With some praise. Hallelujah. He's worthy of it. He's worthy of the praise. Hallelujah. We glorify you, God.
Mighty King,
Holy One,
Praise the Lord. Good evening, saints. I am honored to stand before you this evening and read our occasion statement. This is the 7th annual gathering for this conference, for the Overcoming Hate with Love conference. And tonight, I am going to read you the occasion statement, and then once we are done with that, we are going into a moment of prayer. Amen? Amen. Good evening. Welcome to the 7th annual Overcoming Hate with Love conference. I'm Minister Arthur White, and I'll be reading the occasion statement. 7 years ago, in a church in Charleston, South Carolina, local worshipers welcomed a young man into their evening Bible study. They, the local worshipers, were unaware of the events that would unfold and cost many of them their lives. The young man, during that service, took the lives of 9 of the worshipers present that night. Within 48 hours of the tragedy that unfolded within the walls of Emmanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina, the relatives of those who gave their lives that night were face to face with the man charged with the crime of the death of their loved ones. It is here, in a moment where grief, anger, and deep hatred would be a justified and natural reaction to this tragedy, that we find a remarkable shining light of hope. They set the stage for us, the local communities across the country, who watched this tragedy unfold from a distance, shaping our own opinions and responses and wrestling with our own feelings of justified outrage and the emotional emptiness that comes with feeling helpless in the face of such tragic circumstances. Yet, as they stood facing the young man who had brought such pain and such grief upon their lives, they boldly faced his hatred and attack and attacked it with the only weapon that can successfully defeat this kind of hate. It is here, in the most hopeless of moments, that we find hope. In a moment of deep darkness, that we find light. That day, they set an example for the world to see that would lay the groundwork for a call to action here in our local community. The family members in the courtroom that day were given an opportunity to speak to the person responsible for their pain. As their lives lay in shambles, the ragged emotions of anger and hate, they could have justifiably taken center stage. But these courageous souls raised a banner of hope for us, a banner of love, as they spoke words of forgiveness to the person responsible for their immense pain. As we watch these acts unfold before us, the act of forgiveness in that moment, demonstrated by these family members, demonstrated the power that love has in the midst of hate. In this moment, the family members would give their adversary no quarter, no room for celebration, no acknowledgement of victory, for the victory was theirs as they put their trust in God that somehow his love would prevail. Jesus tells us as his followers in Matthew 5, 43 through 46, that when we are confronted with evil, that we are to love our enemies, that we are to bless those who curse us, we are to do good to them that hate us, and pray for those who would despitefully use us and persecute us. Yes, I believe that these courageous people, in the midst of mourning their lost loved ones, gave us a blueprint for combating the destructive powers of hate by putting love in action. Since this moment in time marked the inception of our local effort to bring attention to the need to deploy Christ's love in the face of hatred, there have been a number of attacks that have taken many innocent lives, most notably and most recently in Buffalo, New York, where there were 10 fatalities from 20 to 86 years of age, and also in Uvalde, Texas, with a loss of a total of 22 lives, 17 of which were elementary school children and 2 teachers. Consequently, since the incident in Buffalo on 14 May, we have had at least 50 or more mass shootings, resulting in either multiple injuries or multiple loss of life. It is in this environment, in this moment of our lifetime, that we have an opportunity to make our mark in history. That compels us to move forward in solidarity, to not be paralyzed by the enormity of the circumstance, but to use this occasion of bringing our community together to demonstrate this type of commitment to be shining lights of loving kindness, battling the attempts of hatred to gain a foothold in our community. We believe that hopefully by the example they set, it will galvanize us us all to do more and be more vigilant and meet our adversary head on with the power that overcomes all evil, God's love. Tonight, we celebrate the efforts and accomplishments of local community members who have made a significant impact on our community with their efforts to continue to overcome hate with love. Amen. Amen. Let us go before the throne of grace. If you would bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight, O Lord, humbly and yielded for your service. Father, we ask tonight that in the midst of this service and this congregation, that your very presence would reign, that you would come in and meet with us here in this place, that you would prepare our hearts and minds for the work ahead, that you would lead us by your Spirit and guide us to do that which you have called us in the earth to do, to be salt and light. Father, you told us that love would cover a multitude of sins. So tonight, as we take a moment to stop and pause and commemorate the lives that have been lost over the years to these tragic circumstances, and as we take a moment to give thanks and to recognize those in our local community who have stepped out into the forefront to take on the mantle that was passed on to us as an example by your son Jesus in his life, death, crucifixion, burial, and resurrection. Help us to leave this place tonight, Lord God, with a renewed energy to also enter into the fray and take our opportunities to smother out hatred's vile presence with the love that Christ has given us on the inside. So tonight, Lord, we just want to say thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for just being a part of your very purpose in the earth, that we might be light and love in the midst of darkness and chaos. And Father, we just want to give thanks and honor to your name for just giving us the power to be able to overcome every obstacle that is set in our way. And we'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. We ask all things in Jesus' name, that every heart say amen, amen, and amen.
Turn on now. Welcome, everyone, to this year's Overcoming Hate with Love service. When we started this 7 years ago, I thought about what it would be like to be in a worship service and hear gunfire erupt. And as a result of that, I thought about the importance of turning the tone down and thinking about the power of God's love. So I'm excited to be here again, celebrating love over hate. I now have the honor to introduce our U.S. Congressman Brent Guthrie. And I'm going to say some very formal remarks and then reflect back on our visit last month in his office in Washington, D.C. Congressman Brent Guthrie represents Kentucky's 2nd Congressional District. He serves on the House Energy and Commerce Committee. He's married to Beth Guthrie, and they have 3 children, 2 daughters, Elizabeth and Caroline, and a son, Robbie. He is a graduate of Yale School of Management at Yale University. Last month, I got an opportunity to visit with Congressman Guthrie, and it's interesting because, Judge Shumate, you've done Hill Day with us, and we had a snafu in trying to get scheduled with his office, and so we missed it. And so as I was leaving one congressman's office, about to turn the corner, I looked this corner opposite, and it said Brent Guthrie. And I said, I know this guy. And so I peeked in the office and I said, hey, we didn't have a meeting, and I understand. And the lady said, well, the congressman's not here anyway. I said, but please let him know Pastor Palmer is in town. I'll be here for the rest of the week, and I'd love to see him. Needless to say, before I made it back to my hotel room, they were tracking me down, and he was excited about the opportunity to spend time with me. And so I got an opportunity to meet with him, and while we met, he told me a story that really sat at a special place in my heart. He told me about a woman in her 90s named Thelma in Bowling Green, Kentucky. And he says every time he's in state, he and Thelma have a regular date to Captain D's. Thelma is 90, in her 90s, and Thelma often tells him about her life in Jim Crow era, oppression. And one of the statements she's often made to him was that I live half of my life going to color-only restaurants and color-only restrooms and color-only fountains. So when President Obama got elected, you can imagine how historic this event was. Each representative of Congress got two tickets for the podium. That was for them and a significant other. Congressman Guthrie gave his second ticket to Thelma. Because he knew, yes, not his wife, not one of his children, not a significant family member. This historic event, he gave that honor to Thelma. But he said to Thelma, he said, if anyone asks you, tell him you're my wife. Thelma said, wait a minute now. What do you mean I'm your wife? He said, well, you're supposed to be a family member to use this second ticket. Thelma said, okay then. Today I'll be your wife, but not tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you Congressman Brett Guthrie.
She did do that. That was funny. President Obama and I got elected on the same day as you got elected. I got a phone call from her. She was 81 at the time. And that's when she said, she goes, I want to go to the night. She said, you know who I am, don't you? And I got a lot of phone calls. So I said, well, you're going to have to give me a little more than, do you know who I am? I can't tell by your voice. And so she was. And we sat together every Dr. King breakfast. That's where we always look her up and find her. She's a wonderful lady. And that's absolutely true. And she said, I want to be at the inauguration. And I said, there are going to be 2 million people there. It's going to be crowded. It's going to be cold. It's going to be whatever. And that's when she said, I drank out of a color-only water fountain half my life. I'm going to be there. And then I found out I got the one ticket. But yeah, she did do that. That's not, if you saw me laughing at the inauguration, because I was still laughing about her going off to the, she had to go off to another room, and we went to the house to go to a podium. I said, now tell him you're my, wife, because you're not going to pass for my mother. That's what I told her. She goes, okay, I'll be your wife today, but not tonight. So that's a great story. I remember, and I'm just going to be brief, because I know you got, I get to open for Judge Shoemake here tonight, so I'm just going to just talk for a couple of minutes, 5 minutes, I think I said, so I'll take every bit of it. But I was in Charleston. Last time I was in Charleston, I went by Emmanuel. And I don't know if you've had the chance to do that. And it is its old historic church from the outside. But my goodness, isn't I have the soul in the inside. And what the examples you saw and the family members, I don't know how I'd react to that. I really don't know how I'd react to that. But I sure hope I would react the way that they react. Because they acted the way Jesus would react to it. And that has always touched me about their spirit-filled people there. So I was going to talk about a little bit. It's kind of interesting. If you come to D.C. and you do a tour of the Capitol building, there's a little anecdote you get when you tour the Capitol building. You go to the old Senate where they met through the 1850s, and there's a desk where they have a book sitting on the desk, and they always, so if you're going through, said that was the last caning. That's where a guy named Charles Sumner, Senator Sumner from Massachusetts, got hit over the head with a cane, almost killed by a guy named Edward Brooks from South Carolina, from Charleston, actually, South Carolina. And so they tell that story, and it was an argument over slavery. That's what they say. So so Charles Sumner was an abolitionist, made a speech against slavery, and the guy from South Carolina came, and this is in the 1850s, right before the Civil War, and caned him and almost killed him. And so they tell that story, and you kind of move on. And so I was kind of interested, if you pique my interest, who's Charles Sumner and why did he One was the abolitionist. That was mine. He became one of my favorite characters in American history. Almost nobody's ever heard of. I guarantee you, if he hadn't got caned, you wouldn't have heard of him before. But he essentially was the author of the 13th and the 14th Amendments. So author of ending slavery and the author of equal protection under the law, which is what the argument was for Brown versus Board of Education in the 14th Amendment. And so why did he do that? And what's interesting about him, he was a patrician from Massachusetts. They would call him the Boston Brahmins, the old school, went to Harvard, graduated in the 1830s, and was finished. Finished with school, was about to start his legal career, never really thought about a political career. And people of that stature in those days with that kind of money, he went to France. So he went to Paris to finish his education. So he went to the Sorbonne, as we would call it now. I'm not sure what the title of it was then. So he goes to university in Paris just to finish his finishing. That's what they called it back then. But he didn't finish his education. He was re-educated and educated. He was sitting in a class with, as you know, the colony situation in the world at the time. But there were seven Africans in Paris that they were training to go back to one of their colonies. And he happened to be in class with them. So there's all these people from America, people from France, French people, and these seven Africans. And he said throughout the beginning of the year, he avoided them. By the end of the year, he looked at them and he says, you know, the only thing difference between me and you is the color of our skin. There is no difference. He goes, he's just never been around people of African or African descent. Just never hit in his world. He's just never around it. And he said, I came back to America determined to end slavery because I realized there's just no difference between the two. Now, we all know that, but he didn't know it because he just never experienced it. How did he know it? Because he spent time with each other. And I think that's the message that I took from him. If he had never taken the time to be around people that are different from you, whether we look different, we have a different accent, we may think different sometimes, we may be different in different occasions, but if you're only around people that look and talk and think like you do, you're never going to be enriched. You're never going to learn their side of the story. You're never going to learn their point of view. And he did that. And so by just being exposed to people and realizing, as we all know, there's no difference. It changed his life. It changed the course of this country because he was willing to expose himself. So you talk about love over hate. The first thing you need to do is get to know each other. Get to spend time together. Let's get to know. When they told me Pastor Palmer's in town, and I just missed him, I said, well, see if he's close by. I didn't know you're already back at your hotel. He called you back. I said, I want to see him. We've gotten to know each other. It's just the thing that I think is so important. And one of the things that I'm trying to figure out how to deal with, and I think as a leader in this country, we all have our own television stations we watch. We have our own different things that we do. We have different groups that we hang out with. And we never really try to make the effort to make sure somebody else is included or we're included in somebody else's event and making sure that we're available so people know who we are and why we think the way that we think. And I guarantee we're going to find there's a lot more alike between us than different. And if we spend enough time together, if I didn't know Pastor Palmer, I'd like him. Now that I know him, I love him. And I think that all of us have those situations. If I knew him better, I might not. Is that what you're chuckling for? I see him chuckling over here. I might not love him as much if I knew him well, right? So that's my point. There was a gentleman whose name you probably wouldn't know, Charles Sumner, if you didn't tour the Capitol building and know that he got caned. And the only reason, but what did he do? He was the author of the 13th and 14th Amendment, which freed Emancipation Proclamation. Slavery in the Confederate States, the 13th Amendment ended it for our country. And then the 14th Amendment, this is not only we're going to end slavery, we're going to make sure everybody's treated equal. And that's because he was willing to get out of his comfort zone and get to know people that don't look like he looks, talk like he talks. I'm sure they had a different accent than he had. If they had a French accent, they had a different accent than he had. But he looked at it, all those differences that on appearance, there was no difference in the heart. And that's what we need to recognize. So thank you for having me here tonight. Thank you for being part of it. And let's continue to share the message of love over hate. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to ask that you would please remain silent as we light a candle and read the names of each of the victims of the Charleston, South Carolina shooting. Susie Jackson, 87 years old. Reverend Daniel Simmons, 74 years old. Ethel Lance, 70 years old. Myra Thompson, 59 years old. Cynthia Hurd, 54 years old. DePayne Middleton Doctor, 49 years old. Reverend Sharonda Coleman Singleton, 45 years old. Reverend Clementa Pinckney, 41 years old. Tawanza Sanders, 26 years old. And the 10th candle is lit in memorial for victims prior to and after this tragic event.
Help me on my journey.
Help me on my journey.
need you to help me.
Oh, Lord, while I'm waiting, I need you to help me.
While I'm waiting, I need you to help me.
Love, a strong affection for another arising out of kinship or personal ties. Affection based on admiration, benevolence, or common interest. Love. But here, I live in a nation that sends out so much misinformation, whose presentation of liberty and justice fails, delays, and stalls. A nation who was established with the statement, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Happiness. So I asked the question, Lord, how do I overcome this world's adversities? How do I open blind eyes to see? God's response to me, He says, daughter, have peace in me. In this world, you'll have trouble, but I've overcome the world. Take courage, I've overcome the world. And then it begins. He shows me how to win, to draw his people right back to him. I lift up my head, I stick out my chin, I open my eyes, and then it begins. I see him walking the streets. Everyone that I meet looks like my father, my son, and my daughters. How do I get them? How do I get them? With love from the one up above. I open my heart. I open my hands. I look for God's heart. In my fellow man, I remember the cross and the things he sustained. I remind myself of what he went through. How they whipped and they lied and they called him names too. How they once gave him praise, then murdered him in days. But he never changed. He never changed. See, he knew back then what we would go through when we don't know love, that we would act a fool. Yes, we would act a fool. How we judge because of money or the color of our skin, and because we don't take time out to learn of him. I'm here to remind you to look back to then when we wrote, "All men are created equal," and read that again and again. We overcome our hate when we see we are him, God's greatest creation, the ones he calls friends. Every man, every nation, every man in every nation, we get them with love. We get them with love. We get them with love. Thank you.
Got no place to be. That's why I'm starting with me. I'm up and then make the change. I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. And no message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and then make that change. I'm asking him to change. Take a look at yourself and then make the change. You gotta get it right while you got the time. Cause when you close your heart, you can close your mind. With the man in the mirror, I'm asking him to change his ways. And no message could have been any clearer. If you wanna make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and then make the change.
Thank God them kids got their granddaddy's genes. Sang just like their granddaddy. Praise Jesus. They pay me at this church not to sing. Praise God. I want to get a good offering from the praise scene, just threaten to sing with them. Amen. Well, it gives me a great honor to introduce our speaker. And I didn't even think about a bio for Judge Shoemate until a couple days ago. And then she sent me this book and said to me, this was just a couple of hours ago, she said, you're going to have to trim that down. And so I went through it and tried to figure out what not to say, thinking I'm going to take the wrong parts out and probably put the wrong parts in. But I'll start by just saying, from a experiential point of view, she's a friend to this ministry, to Angie and I, and to the work that I believe God has called me to, and been a friend since Daniel was on the inside of her. I met her 25 years ago, and when I met her, she was out to here, about to give birth to Daniel. And she's been a friend. Her and I have served locally on committees. We've served on state committees together, and we've served on national committees together. And so a lot has been accomplished in the establishment of this relationship. But Judge Kimberly Shoemate is the district judge of the 9th Judicial District of Hardin County, Kentucky. She is married to Bryce Shoemate, a retired police officer and chief emergency service coordinator for Hardin County. Bryce and Kim have one daughter, Megan Cable, 31, of Elizabethtown, who is married to Michael, a worship pastor at Grace Heartland Church. Megan and Michael have given her the greatest gifts of grandchildren, Ellie Joy, who is with the Lord, and Denver Lee Cable, who is a wonderful toddler full of life and love, and I will say some very interesting expressions at times. I think he's been here before. Judge Shoemate has also has one son, Daniel Shoemate, of Elizabethtown, 24, who serves as Hardin County Deputy Sheriff and is married to Callie, a fifth grade teacher here at Meadowview Elementary School. She is a regular presenter at the Judicial College and Judicial Education here in the state of Kentucky. She serves on the Judicial Education Committee and has been instrumental in establishing teen court, drug court, and veterans court in Hardin County. And she is always bragging about her teen court, her drug court, and her veterans court. Her honors include the 2002 recipient of the State Foster Care Review Board Outstanding Judge Award, the 2005 Youth Leader by the Knights of Templar of Kentucky, the 2006 Destiny Award from the Kentucky Child Now Project for her work with the youth in Kentucky, her 2006 Community Volunteer of the Year Award from the Rack Chamber of Commerce, and the NAACP Humanitarian Award in 2008. In 2014, she received the award from the Secretary of State for Civil Education. In 2015, she received the Peacemaker Awards from the Sign of the Dove Church in this very community service. Recently in 2020, both Judge Shoemate and her husband, Bryce, were awarded the Humanitarian Award from the Hardin County NAACP. Currently, Judge Shoemate is working with the Chief Justice of the Kentucky Supreme Court to create a certification standard for treatment courts throughout the state. Judge Shoemate is a member of Grace Heartland Church of Elizabethtown, where she is active in the women's ministry. Please help me welcome our dear friend, Judge Kimberly Shoemate.
This work? It works for me. All right. Good evening, and thank you so much for letting me be a part of your evening tonight. It was in 2015 that we first gathered with our Peacemakers Award, and it made a great impression on me, and I know it did on Pastor Palmer because he's kept it up for the next 7 years. And so I was very thankful that I was able to be with you all tonight to share once again. I've done my best to be here at each of those along the way, and I intend to continue to do so as long as you give voice to this community for this special message. Tonight, your message was based on Colossians 3:14, and it says, "And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity." I think our hearts and our minds have been at one accord, and the Lord was, and the Holy Spirit was moving in each of those parts along the way. I loved your message in poetry, your message in song, the words that Congressman Guthrie gave. They're all tied together already. And so I feel like the message I'm going to give you, you've already heard in lots of different ways tonight. You've heard it even on the videos along the way. But hopefully I can tie it together and give you a call to action before we leave tonight. Since 2015, we've been gathering here at the Sign of the Dove as a community to bring to the forefront the compelling need for love to overcome hate. In response to violence in our country, Pastor Palmer has been spearheading these gatherings to bring attention to the issue and to try and open channels of communication with the purpose to try and keep violence from overtaking in our community. All too often, we hear of mass shootings in public places, in churches, in shopping malls, in schools. I went through and looked at some of the ones that you saw on your video, And I looked since we met together in June of 2015. The list was so long that I pared it down to only the ones that loss of life was at 10 or more. And it was still such an enormous list. It is a heavy list. And I'm going to share it with you because just like those candles that you've seen lit tonight, we want to remember those events. We want to remember those people because those are precious lives that were lost. And we cannot lose sight of that when we watch the television and our eyes glaze over. So I want you to hear these and remember these tonight. On June 17, 2015, a white supremacist terrorist mass shooting occurred at Charleston, South Carolina, in which 9 African Americans were killed during a Bible study at Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church. That shook a bunch of us. We like to think of our houses of worship as a sanctuary where evil can't enter, but we know that God is among us and it's not just inside wood and timber, and that there'll be purposes, and that all things will come together for good, but all things won't feel good when they're coming together, right? And so in the midst of all that, during that Bible study was when that shooting took place. And that killer was convicted in federal court and is serving a death sentence and awaiting execution. Since that time, the hatred and the violence and the lack of sanctity for human life has continued in our country. In October of 2015, in Rosenberg, Oregon, a student at the Umpqua Community College killed 9 before taking his own life. Shortly after, on December the 2nd of 2015, in San Bernardino, California, yet another senseless loss of life where a couple killed 14 of his work colleagues before losing their own lives. For some of you, your minds are already flashing back pictures of what you saw on the news media during some of those occasions. On June 16 of 2016, 50 lives in Orlando, Florida were taken at a gay nightclub. Hatred. On October the 1st of 2017 in Las Vegas, Nevada, the horrific loss of 61 lives when a gunman shot down from his hotel room to a crowd of country music concert goers. On November the 5th of 2017 at the First Baptist Church of Sutherland Springs, Texas, Devin Patrick Keeley killed 27 souls, including an unborn child and himself. On February 14, Valentine's Day in 2018 in Parkland, Florida, at the Stoneman Douglas High School, a former student shot and killed 17 souls. On May the 18th of 2018 in Santa Fe, Texas, in the Santa Fe High School, a student shot and killed 10 people. November 7th of 2018 at Thousand Oaks, California, was the site of a student line dancing event, and 13 in attendance lost their lives at the hand of a gunman who later took his own life. On October 27th of 2018, at a synagogue in Pittsburgh, was a site of an anti-Semitic mass shooting where 11 were killed, making it the deadliest attack ever on a Jewish community in the U.S. I still remember listening to the stories of some who had survived the Holocaust but died in that attack. They survived the Holocaust but fell victim to the violence of today's society. On May the 31st of 2019, in Virginia Beach, there were 12 that were shot and killed in a municipal building before the gunman took his own life. On August the 3rd of 2019, in El Paso, Texas, 23 souls perished when a gunman targeted Hispanics at a Walmart. Hatred. The very next day, August 4th of 2019, in Dayton, Ohio, a gunman and 9 others lost their lives outside a bar where 27 more were injured. On May the 26th of 2021, in San Jose, California, 10 lives were taken when a shooter killed 9 at a transportation authority and then took his own life. And still so fresh in our minds, Uvalde, Texas, where on just May the 24th, we lost 22 lives, 3 adults and 19 children in a school shooting. And on May the 14th of 2022 in Buffalo, New York, the site of another racially motivated gunman killing 10 at the supermarket. I recall each of these tonight because sometimes in the news we can just glaze over as if it doesn't affect us personally, as if there's nothing we can do, so why mourn? Why talk about it? Why even give it thought? It's somewhere else. It's someone else. There's nothing I can do. So why indeed? What do you expect of me? The TV talking heads can speculate all day. Folks can fuss at our lawmakers and ask for consideration of gun laws. But I'm not in Congress. Are you? Now, I wrote this before I knew that you were going to be here, Congressman Guthrie. So that was not an intentional prod. But for most of us, we are looking at those situations and we say, what can I do? What do you expect of me? I just live in Hardin County, Kentucky. What authority do I have? What opportunity for change do I have? Is there something we can or should expect of ourselves, our community? And I'm here to argue, yes. We have individual and corporate responsibilities, first to love and then to act. We're a people called to love by our Maker, because only love will overcome hatred. A greater hatred will not overcome hatred. Only love can do that. We've seen love in action when our Savior walked this earth and those around him recorded all that he said and did for us to later hear. We have a responsibility to love like that. We should study and learn and then do. In order to know what Jesus would do, we have to know Jesus. Study him by studying his word and applying it daily. Are you studying? Are you searching? Corporately, personally, in public places of worship, and in private times of study and reflection. Are you? His word and his life will change who you are, and it will change the way that you see the world. Are you reading secular authors who challenge how you think? I hope so. One of my favorite secular authors that makes me take stock of my own perspective is a woman named Jodi Picoult. It's P-I-C-O-U-L-T. Took me forever to figure out how to say that until I finally saw her on a video and somebody introduced her. I always call her Jodi Picoult, but it's Jodi Picoult. She said it's kind of like pico de gallo, a little bit hot. Okay. She takes the hot button issues in society and writes them from the perspective of the many who are touched by them. One of my favorites of late is one called Small Great Things. Its title comes from the words of Martin Luther King Jr. He says, if I cannot do great things, I can do small things in a great way. And this particular book addresses the racial inequities in our society that are all too often pushed aside or brushed aside. And it makes you think. Are you reading to think and try to see life from the perspective of others? Are you studying? Are you reading? Empathy, the ability to understand and share the feelings of others. Empathy is a friend of love, and by relation then, an opponent of hatred. When we empathize with others, we learn to see life from their perspective. It becomes more difficult to hate. Even if we cannot love the ideas or beliefs someone holds, we can still love them. I'm going to say that one more time, because that is not easy to swallow. Even if we cannot love the ideas or beliefs that someone else holds, we can still love them. Even if the only redeeming quality in our eyes they hold is that we're made by the same Creator, we can love that much about them. We don't have to like them to love them. Love is the only thing that has the power to extinguish hatred. You've heard this. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. That's another of my favorite MLK quotes. So do you love or do you hate? I'm just going to say it. You cannot hate people and love God. You cannot love God and hate his people. Black or white or whatever shade, gay or straight, Muslim or Jewish or Christian, no matter, they are all God's people. We are all God's children. We are created in love to love. And one of the youth organizations I work with, we say, that love is of God, and when you love, you are like him. I just think that's a wonderful message to teach our young people. Love is of God, and when you love, you are like him. We are created in love to love. What responsibility do we have? It is simple, to love, to put on love, to put it on like a garment and wear it like it's our favorite sweatshirt. We will never know whether or not someone's love could have intervened in those situations of the mass shootings that we gave a roll call to tonight. But we may also never know what hatred we thwarted with our love, what heinous acts our love may have countered. It's the difficulty of measuring the negative. Much like when Pastor Palmer and I do delinquency prevention work for juveniles, we put into place programs with mentoring and with counseling, and we can see positive changes that we can measure in grades or attendance, and we can see it sometimes in attitudes, even if we can't measure it with certain at-risk students that we've identified. So we can measure attendance and grades, but we can't count what delinquent acts were prevented because, well, they never happened. Does that mean that our mentoring and our programming and our love was irrelevant? No. I fully believe that those touches from those positive adults kept those youth on the right track and kept what could have been serious delinquent behavior from ever occurring. So even if you can't quantify it or measure it, your acts of love matter. The chain reaction of love begets more love, and love more empathy, which drives out the darkness and the hate. If you don't see the progress, love anyway. If you don't think your actions are making a difference, love anyway. If you don't know if anything you could ever personally do could ever possibly affect the numbers that you've heard tonight about shootings and about violence, love anyway. You will never know the lives you touch and the future you alter by your love. So love anyway. With that said, we're going to end where we began today in Colossians 3:14. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. May the Holy Spirit prick your hearts. May God's words open your minds to his perfect way and your lives into action into his will. May the perfect love of God the Father irrevocably alter your life and all those around you starting this very day, rippling throughout your community, forever changing the trajectory for good. My challenge to you, put on love and love anyway.
Well, I know what Judge Shoemake's going to do when she leaves the bench. She's going to be a preacher. I just know it. It was the love of God that altered the course of history for all mankind. And so her challenge was to us was to love anyway. And we never know what that act of love, that act of kindness, is going to alter. You may meet the gunman on the way into the Walmart, and with a kind word, with a gentle look, you may alter the course of an event that will never happen. Love anyway. The day after the Uvalde shooting, I have the honor of participating in the lives of 6 grandchildren. But one particular lives with me, and every morning when I'm in town, I jump at the occasion to get up, do everything I need to do, get dressed, so that I can be ready to walk her to the bus stop. Now, when I'm not here, she tells her mom to just send her out to the bus. Can I go by myself? But when I'm here, we walk to the bus stop together holding hands. And sometimes we sing our favorite song, People Let Me Tell You About My Best Friend. Yeah. But the day after the Uvalde shooting, as we walked to that bus, I had a different feeling in my heart. And I remember looking up at the bus driver, and I was very intentional in saying to him, thank you for keeping my baby safe. And so as I thought about the awardee for this year's Peacemaker Award, and as I look back at our first responders, I talk with Chief probably every week to do exactly what Judge Shumate talked about and exactly what Congressman Guthrie talked about, and that was to keep some consistent dialogue. No community is immune from the possibility of tragedy. But if we build the relationships we need to build, as we have good times and times of peace, if one of those tragic events should befall us, we already have the relationships to sit down, to have dialogue, and to get our community to a better place. We don't need the talking heads from national media. We don't need national groups. We don't need national folks to come in and organize a protest, because we've built relationships to sit down at the table and to get through those difficult times. So as I thought about Layla in school, I realized that our first responders, when it comes to a school shooting, are not really our first responders. By the time Chief and his guys get there, a lot has already transpired. So the real first responders, when it comes to second graders and third graders, are those teachers, those principals, those custodial workers, those lunchroom workers. They're running around trying to figure out how to keep Layla safe, how to get our babies under tables and into locker rooms and closets. They're the ones that, instead of being 19 children, instead of being 29 or 39 children, it was only 19, and that's too much, but because of some teacher, because of some janitor, lives were saved. And I realized that our teachers and the folks that are locked into those school buildings with our kids are the ones keeping them safe. They're the ones I'm counting on. If anything like that ever happens to a school where one of my loved ones attends, our educators. And without thought, they put their lives on the line and they start protecting them babies. And so today, I want to honor our Hardin County school professionals. Everybody from the superintendent all the way down to the custodial workers. Because if they're in that school building, they're the ones I'm counting on to keep my baby safe. So I'm going to ask the representative from Hardin County School, and I'm going to ask our past Peacemaker recipients to come and stand with me in this honor. Chief, if you'll come, I know RPD has received the Peacemaker's Award. Just you, mate, if you'll come. I know the superintendent's out on vacation. We'll wait and let the chief get up here. Trust me, he moves faster than that in emergencies. I've seen him. Both Judge Shumate and Chief Cross have also received this award, again, for their work in keeping our community safe and keeping our community peaceful. So we want to recognize you, but all those who work in education with you. This is the Community Peacemaker Award 2022. It's presented to the Superintendent of Hardin County Schools, the staff, and the faculty. And it says, blessed are the peacemaker, for they shall be called sons of God. I want to thank you all for what you do. Thank you all for keeping our kids safe. Thank you for being on the front lines. Let's give it up for Hardin County Schools. We appreciate you. Okay. Thank you all. Thank you, Church. I think they have a final song, and then I'll close us out with prayer. Take time out. There are some significant folks in the place. I do want to recognize, I do want to first of all recognize my colleague in the gospel, Pastor Wilson from Hope Temple Church of God in Christ. We appreciate you, man. Love you. And I only see, other than the congressman and Judge Shumate, I only see Celine Hudson, who's also been a great friend for a couple decades now, Vine Grove City Councilwoman. Appreciate her. Amen. And I do want to say that our contact for Congressman Guthrie is Brian Smith, who's also here running for county clerk. So if you ever need to get in touch with the congressman, I think Kenny got a list of issues for him. He came in the door. Kenny got him on driver's license. He had a whole bunch of issues. I was like, Kenny, he's not here working tonight. Get in touch with Brian. Brian's the guy connects us to the congressman. Again, we appreciate you being here. When I was in D.C., he told me, man, you got to let me know when something's going on in the community. I want to be there. You know, you hear that from a politician in Washington, D.C., in this huge federal context. You think, oh, well. But he was serious, you know, and so I sent this to Brian. Brian sent it to him, and he says, I'll be there. And so we appreciate you. We know you're very busy. So we appreciate you taking time to be here. I want to thank you for that spoken word. Again, we appreciate that. And as always, Judge Shumate, you are just refreshing, right? So we love you, and thank you for being here as well. I do want to give honor to my lovely wife in the back. Look, we talking about you. You talking to James? Praise Jesus. That happens when I'm preaching too. Your wife do that when you preaching, man? They just do their own thing. So. Praise Jesus. Amen. I'm going to pay for that later. I know. Amen. Stand to your feet. Again, let's give thanks to Hardin County Schools for the great work that they do. Father, we thank you. We give you glory. We give you honor. We thank you for all that has been spoken, the songs that have been sang. We thank you, O God, for the charge that has been given to love anyway, to love always. So God, as we leave this place, may we never be from your presence. May your grace and the sweet communion of your spirit rest with us until we all meet again. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you. Love on two or three people before you leave. Love on somebody.